members of the public for coming today. Thank you to members of the public who have come along today to observe these proceedings. Can I just remind you that this is actually a private meeting held in public? So you are here, and I know it's an emotive subject and a contentious issue, I might add, but could I ask you please to refrain from calling me out or whatever, please? Okay, thank you. So we'll now proceed. We're here today as a call-in, which has been called in by been told to go through the procedure first before I explain how the call has been called. Apologies for any absence from any members. Members' code of conduct and declarations of interest. Has anybody got any declarations of interest to declare? Tom?
Thank you, Chair. Just in relation to the council. Special counsel the other day. I did vote at that council. I come here with an open mind to listen to all the arguments or make my decision solely based on these arguments I've been reading today.
Clearly, thank you, Chairman. Likewise, from my colleague, Councillor Anderson, I was present at council a week today, just on, and I was second. But like everybody else, I'm sure I'm sitting here willing to be persuaded by any arguments made, and I think actually government guidelines actually says that we are permitted to sit on such.
Is that the same here, John?
Yes.
And Steve, all the same? Yeah. It has been noted.
Thank you, Chair. Given the email that was sent out today by Councillor Rooney, how will the process go in relation to the
Well, I haven't seen it. I haven't seen the
Well, email. I think it would be advisable for most members to read that particular email that's been sent off by Councillor Rooney today in relation to Friends of Country Park and car parking charges.
Right, well, can I say I haven't seen the email, so I can't comment on that. But what I can say is that if there's any predetermination issues, I have discussed it with the head of the legal department. And it's what's been said so far is absolutely fine. But what I can say is if there's any, depending on how the vote goes, if there's any issues that anyone feels there are issues with, it's then up to members to lodge a complaint and it will be looked at with the twos, the fours and against. So I hope that covers. I haven't seen the email, so I can't comment on it. But we don't want to spend too long on this issue, I don't think. So long as the people who voted at the council meeting have it in their own mind, and you've declared it in the declaration of interest, and as far as I can see, that covers it for where we are at the moment.
I mean, it's not necessarily an email, it's a press release, I understand. I mean, I have it here, it was issued this afternoon at 13:39. Would it be advisable for the committee to have sight of it? It's a public
If that's the... I've seen that. I've seen that.
Asking for what he's actually alluding to.
Can I just reply to that, Chair?
Can you just clarify the point you were raising before? Just clarify. We don't want these calls.
It basically states join a friends of parks for a pound a week and you get cheaper car parking.
Sure. Yes, that's what I thought.
Well, that's a decision that hasn't been made yet because we're still discussing that. Now, that's a press release that's been sent out on behalf of the cabinet member for the Labour Party.
Thank you. responding. I believe this change in process has been flawed, and as such, the decision needs to be referred back to the decision maker. I'd ask committee members to remember when the activities you are about to hear stop in the parks due to the administration's imposition of these charges, what the true cost will be to the people of Wirral and to the council. Back in December, when the council leader presented his medium-term financial strategy to Cabinet, he indeed the narrative was a budget option to raise £1.5 million in car parking revenue. As you'll be aware, Chair, just enough to cover the need he's holding out at the moment on interims, contractors and consultants. Over 33,000 people opposed the various parking charges and schemes proposed, and after some or much stage-managed public hand-wringing and a front page of the council's newspaper, the leader of the council was forced into performing an embarrassing but only partial U-turn on his parking proposals. So, Chair, we're now talking about schemes that will generate £150,000 in income for parks and £220,000 for existing charges. To install machines in parks will cost £80,000 and £22,000 per year to operate the service. The net income generated will be £48,000. In other words, just £12,000 per park. All this upset, worry, and lack of joined-up thinking for £12,000 per park. You'll hear shortly from the Friends of Royden Park, who will no doubt will explain how the Friends are tackling issues of social isolation, providing a meeting place for vulnerable adults and encouraging families to use the park for a healthy and an expensive day out. Friends have also raised over £25,000 to improve the facilities of Royden Park, and this administration wants to jeopardise all that amazing work to raise just £12,000. Simply ridiculous. As well as the barking mad cafe in Wynne Park, the other parks all have cafes associated with them, small businesses that employ local people. Three people are employed at the Red Room Cafe in Arrow Park, nine at the Mimosa in Eastern Country Park, and 10 people at GJ's in Wirral Country Park. That's a total of 21 people whose jobs are directly impacted by the number of visitors in the parks. I respectfully ask the committee what value they place on those 21 jobs, and if it's greater than 48,000, they need to refer this decision back to the leader of the council. Council officers are predicting a 30% decrease in visitor numbers because of the charges. How this administration can pledge it on small businesses to thrive when it's implementing these charges is quite simply beyond me. The Leader of the Council claims to listen to business owners when making his previous parking U-turns, but I urge the committee today to find out from business owners
here.
I'll just sum up if I may, Chair. Whether from the witnesses today, whether the Leader has listened to that. And finally, Chair, at 1:39 today, most bizarrely, the council issued a press release offering residents to become members of Wirral Country Parks, an offer which includes free parking at the country parks. Chair, it looks like this administration's policy is in confusion and disarray, and I would urge the committee to refer the decision on the traffic regulation orders back to the leader of the council. Former highways panel to look at the 2,389 comments to the proposals for those to be considered in full, a complete review of the traffic regulation or the process to be undertaken. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Are there any questions for the lead signatory from any members, please? No?
No, I accept it's net, but of course you'll be aware, Anita, as the deputy leader,
originally officer proposal, I think, that we need to clarify, Chair.
Warren, if you don't believe you turned up, then that's fair enough. As far as I'm concerned, I saw the cabinet proposals. I've actually read the document. It's not about officer proposals. There's a picture of the leader of the council at the front and a whole list of reasons why he was proposing what he was proposing. So you might believe what the leader says, that somehow these are officer proposals. In the cabinet report, the public documents, and they're available, you will see that it was the leader of the council's proposals that then had to have a traffic regulation order. It wasn't this broad, you know, let's have a think and let's have a consult about it. I think you'll find that legally there had to be a traffic regulation order. And like you, Warren, and the chair, we attended a workshop of this committee, I believe, when people were, even members of the Labour group, because they were told off by Jean, as I recall, were absolutely outraged by the charges that were being put forward. So they were a council policy. I think Jean said, we shouldn't be having this discussion here. These are things that should happen in the Labour group, quote unquote. If I misquoted you, I do apologise to you. But that seems to be broadly, you were the chair, you remember what was actually said at that meeting. So in those terms, I think that you, Warren, are suggesting that somehow all the wicked officers that came up with this idea, and that there was no U-turn by the leader of the council, the Labour group, is frankly fanciful.
Jean.
Probably isn't worth saying.
Well, just to clarify, what I said, the officers were there to give us the information. We needed to take it back to and discuss it within our own groups, all the parties, not just the group. You weren't listening.
I think you'll find Chair was, because I think, Jean, you're also telling members of the Labour group off for making the comments they were making in front of everybody else, and that it should be discussed.
So you should discuss it.
Can I just remind all members and the lead signatory, we're here to discuss the car parking charges, not what went on or didn't go on at meeting. One person can remember what, and another person can't remember. Can we stick to what we're here for, please? There doesn't need to be any further comment. But just remember why we're here, please. John.
Thanks very much for that, Chair. I was concerned this tit for tat is a bit distracting. What I would say is that, just to reinforce what Jean said and the questions you've written, you asked and Lauren asked, I was quite clear that then proposals were put to that workshop, were officer proposals at that time. And that's quite clear where it was. What happened after that is a different matter. But that particular meeting, there were clearly proposals coming from officers, because I hadn't seen them, and I'm not sure anybody else had seen them at that time.
Well, if I could help Ron at that stage, all they had to do was... No, question, and I'm trying to answer them as best I can. All they had to do was read the cabinet report about the leader of the cabinet. And I think I actually had the report with me and showed it to Ron. Maybe he's forgotten that.
No, I didn't forget.
Okay, all right. Thank you, Jeff. Oh, Jeff, can you hang on a minute? Jeff, can I just ask Jeff a question then? Obviously, the Labour Group are trying to raise income for the council, or say. Can you suggest briefly a couple of other ways in which the council could make that savings without having to introduce these car parks?
I think there are a whole range of options. They could start spending all the money they're spending on consultants, contractors, and interims, to have an interim director of transformation and an interim head of transformation seems a bit odd to me. They could also, the council newspaper, they could cancel that, they could save money. There's a whole range. Or they could do what they did with the other car parking charges elements of the proposal, which when I spoke to the section 151 officer, asked where that come from, they just hoofed it onto the transformation savings that was going to be made. Apparently that's how they found that money. So we're talking, to remind everybody, we're talking about simply £150,000 and net £12,000 per park. This is ridiculous in terms of what they're putting residents and the businesses through. I'm not interested in tit for tat, Jim. I'm interested in making sure that we send this back to the cabinet member or the decision maker and let them think again.
I couldn't have put it better myself, Mr. Chairman.
I'm sure you would. Steve, did you indicate you'd like to ask? No, I think that's fine with you, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair.
Could I now call the cabinet member, please? Speaking to every single individual business and every individual logistics of that would just be impossible. But you know,
the point that you just made that everybody's in contact with, you've got four major businesses in the Edgemont's Eastern Country Park, which not one of them has been involved in any way or any form. Nobody's contacted them, nobody's spoken to them, it's been forced upon them.
Okay, Dave. Point taken, thank you. Anybody else?
Just a quick question. Remember, did you say, Stuart, that if people signed up to this new scheme, they'd be receiving a monthly newsletter?
An e-newsletter.
So if they didn't have access to the computer, they wouldn't get anything at all?
The scheme has been announced today since there's a range of benefits for everybody wants to be more friendly in the parks. For instance, you get discounts, you get an e-news asset, and a free parking.
Could I just make, I'll call you next, please. Could I just make members aware that the email that members have received today is actually not part of this calling. Hang on, members. Hang on. Can I just say? I've just been made aware of that by the head of the legal department, and that's just part of the process. Nothing more, nothing less. No, Tom. No, I'm coming to Lesley next. Point of order then, and nothing else, Tom.
Thank you, Chair. Just on the light of that advice from the legal officer, when will it be inserted if the cabinet member in that is evident to brought this up? Does that then relate to this committee or not? And in making this decision, members might feel, well, then it could be that this scheme mitigates that situation, and therefore, you know, the original council decision is enhanced, or they may feel that it needs to be reviewed again. So I think this is a material change.
If I can just recap, in terms of the purpose of the call is an opportunity for members of this committee to consider the decision upon which Cabinet took its decision in respect of the car parking issue. The information that you've heard today with regards to the possible changes in charges, whilst you could consider that as a factor, it wasn't part of the decision making of the executive when they made the original decision. So you are here calling in the original decision of the executive and the information and evidence that they considered at that particular time. That said, clearly if there's relevant information you feel should be taken as a board, then you're free to do so. But I need to make that one clear because it's on the original decision and the rationale of the evidence that existed at that particular time. You need to be able to be further to that.
Thank you. Just a point on that advice then from our legal representative. It seems very strange, really, and it's hard not to have this in your mind when we're discussing this, because clearly less than an hour and a half before this committee, the Labour administration, you know, probably in their desperation making decisions on the hoof, as far as I'm concerned, decided to put something out there in the public domain. This is in the public domain. We have all read it. So clearly it must affect some of the questioning that we want to ask. And I hear what the legal representative says on this, but clearly it is extremely relevant because policy, by the looks of it, has been made on the hoof 1 hour and 20 minutes before we sat down to this committee, which, you know, may have some influence. People from the audience, I mean, I'm not in favour of it, but I don't know what members of the audience may think about it. Just smacks to me as if policy is being made on the hoof before we get here, and I think that's totally unacceptable. I would have hoped that the cabinet member could have at least held off to see what was discussed here this afternoon and what recommendations were made. But anyway, having said that, can I just address a couple of questions to the cabinet member? I find it very odd, to say the least, that when you sit down, and clearly I've been, you know, in my time on the council, I've been a cabinet member, and when you're coming to formulate your budget, you ask officers, or at least we've asked officers in the past, give us a full range of how you could save money. They come back with a very complete list of all sorts of issues, and I have to say, you look at those and you say, well, thank you very much, but they are totally unacceptable, and you move those to one side. Did you have sight of such a proposal like that? And if you did, then why didn't you at that point decide that these, what you are trying to impose, these parking charges, both on the country parks and the additional parking, let's not forget, charges on our council-owned car parks, would have a detrimental effect on mainly two issues, which really are your priorities, I understand, and that's attracting business to the area, attracting people to come and visit the area, to help the economy of our area, but also the detrimental effect it would have on one of your other priorities, which is to address the inequalities of health issues with people across the borough. And clearly, what better way of improving people's health and well-being is for them to get out, get into the countryside, get into the open air, as have most of our people who use our day centres. They now do not stay in day centres all day. They go out and they take on the pursuits of some of the environmental projects in our country park. So why, then, as cabinet member, did you not think that these were totally unacceptable proposals and dismiss them right out of sight at the moment that you saw them?
Since this administration came to being, you know, we've taken a consistent approach in terms of what proposals are there to gather feedback from members of the public, and then we've made decisions, you know, accordingly. I feel that, you know, once we, you know, start receiving feedback on how unpopular the original and the other officer proposals were coming, you know, I personally, you know, they'd have to go around and talk to businesses. Obviously, it couldn't speak to any business, and any businesses who I didn't get a chance to get around, apologies, I'm always happy to go and speak to people. But following that feedback, we decided that, you know, the original proposal was too severe, not too far, and the officers are bringing it in, and that's been consistent. It's the consistent approach since this administration took control.
Chair, can I just have a supplementary to that, please? Can you just address the points which I made in relation to the couple of your priorities about attracting business to the area and also improving the inequities in the health of our local residents? I mean, did you not think that these proposals actually flew in the face of those? And really, you know, if you were keen to pursue these and see what the public thought, it makes me wonder really that you haven't really got the ear of local residents, and surely anybody, clearly I would have, as soon as I've seen them, I thought this is something which the public are not going to like, and you're completely out of tune with the views of the local residents.
Absolutely not. It's in terms of the country parks, as a Labour administration, something they want to do, but you look at the fact factors, and go find what's wrong with the cost of savings in the next financial year. £200 million worth of cuts. So the money's got to come from somewhere. We spend over £1 million on our country parks and put more green flags than anywhere else in the country. And I think it's only fair that people will be able to use them. That's the biggest small contribution to all through.
Ron.
Thank you. Just on the comment that Councillor Rennie made around when she was a cabinet member. I've been here long enough to remember when she was a cabinet member. What she has forgot to mention was that we've now put us in our seventh year of austerity measures from this government that's leading to £200 million cuts.
I can't let you finish.
Okay, it's a question of
one. Questions.
Well, I'll make questions to the cabinet.
Just questions only, Ron.
The cabinet members alluded to the savage cuts that we will face and are facing in the future. Would you like to make a comment on the impact making our decision making going forward?
Yeah. Obviously, it's getting tougher and tougher and tougher. As a Labour councillor, as a Labour administration, you know, we've got to be making this country, we've come here to make life
adult social care, children's social care, all the statutory services, which is needed a lot less, no available for everything else. But let's not forget that we've got closely aligned with all the census, there's not many councils who can say that.
Before I bring you in, Dave, I'd like to ask the cabinet member a question. The car parking charges that we're going to introduce to the country parks, what are we going to do with the revenue that we bring in from the car parking charges? Could you just explain what we're going to do with that revenue, please, Stuart?
All that money will be invested back into the parks. So we're asking people use the parks to contribute towards the upkeep. You've got rangers that need to be paid for. How many car parking charges are that? That's absolutely fantastic. Both kept. And they're very expensive, and it's only fair.
So this is a question. So if we did introduce those charges, we wouldn't have the money to maintain the parks in the first place. So the people who are coming to park their cars, the grass would be so high, and the trees, if they got blown down like we had the storms, we wouldn't have the money to cut the grass or fix the trees, and if fences were blown down, we wouldn't have the money to maintain the fences without introducing these charges because of the cuts that have been imposed on us by central government. Is that correct?
Every year it's getting harder and harder and harder to try and find the necessary savings. And obviously we've got to look at every service, and obviously those non-statutory services are probably more the final line than there.
Thank you. Dave?
Thank you, Chair. I've got one of the cabinet member, one of the for the solicitor. The first one for the cabinet member, and surely he should know, being responsible for highways, that any revenue raised in car parking has got to go back to traffic regions, and nothing counts, unless you're going to buy that money in a normal way. But any revenue that's raised by car parking, clearly and hopefully as plainly as I can. Given the comment from the cabinet member in relation to his colleague on the cabinet, given the option for being a member of a country park, you will get reduced car parking charges. Does that not mean it's a pre-decision?
Yeah.
Predetermined decision that's already been made by the cabinet? Because if they're saying now, become a member of the country park and you get free car parking. We haven't made that decision yet to pass on to cabinet. Is that not a pre-decision?
Standing in as I understand it for the
suggestions were looked at by your party and by the leader of the council and amended, and became the proposals from your party. Is that right or wrong?
What's an old resolution?
In that case, why have we had the suggestion that these were officers' recommendations? What came before council were not officers' recommendations. You looked at the various proposals they made, you picked out what suited you, and that's what was put before council. Is that right?
What we thought the council was, what was an Aberdeen resolution, is what we supported as an administration. The original proposals were officer proposals, which was 50p, and instructions.